And I will not discuss your because it was such a nice introduction. So glad to have you all here. First of all, I have an apology to make. It's for the audio engineer of the evening. We couldn't hire the very best audio engineer. We only got me. And it's also very ancient technology. So don't count on too much. I got a kick the other day. I think it was the Jay Leno show about when they get another one of these audio tapes from Osama bin Laden. He said, where the heck do you get audio tapes these days? I mean, is there some Radio Shackistan out in the Middle East that's selling these damn things? I had to look all over the place to find an old audio tape. Well, anyhow, it's on audio tape, and it won't be high fidelity. I need to start, however, after apologizing, with a couple of disclaimers. First of all, the nirvana of the night is not the nirvana of Buddhism. And if you came here hoping to learn how to achieve Satori, I recommend you go to the Ilsley Library directly above us, and where they have some excellent books on that subject matter. No, the nirvana of the talk tonight is this one, and if I push the right button, it will come out. I hope. I assume this thing is on.
Is the volume on?
Is this plug actually? Is the plug actually working?
Let's try it. Can we try over here?
Sure. Yeah, I can't tell whether it doesn't have, you know, one of these things doesn't even have a power light on it, you know, how often do you get. This talk could be done without the audio.
Oh, what?
Now we'll try it again.
As long as you're going to headbang, that's all I care about.
It's
tape. Yeah, it's tape. There you go. This is the Nirvana. The whole thing. Now, that Nirvana, that piece was called Smells Like Teen Spirit. And it was by the rock, grunge rock band Nirvana. And it's the band leader, Kurt Cobain, and the rock music that I'm going to discuss tonight. The album Nevermind, which opened Smell Like Teen Spirit, went platinum in 1992, which means it sold millions of records. But that was a long time ago. I recognize the fact that freshmen at Middlebury College weren't born in 1992. And there are a few people in this audience who may not have tuned into pop music since Frank Sinatra or Bing Crosby or Fred Neusberger like Al Jolson or maybe Kay Teeter to Sophie Tucker. I don't know. It's a way back anyhow. So anyhow, I just going to try to bring you up to date on what's happened to pop music. The second disclaimer I want to make is that I'm not a fan or a scholar of rock music, and I'll explain to you in a couple of minutes why it is that I'm interested in this. But in the meantime, this is the kind of music that I really favor. Judith and I listen to quite a lot of string quartets. So this will be a little bit of a relaxation for you for the second. A daughter who's a professional violinist. I don't know what exactly she would have thought about that, but there it is. That's not quite my favorite. It's the string quartet version of Smells Like Teen Spirit. Yeah. I'm glad you caught that.
Yeah.
Thank you. The fact that there is a string quartet version of Smells Like Teen Spirit may give you some idea about why Nirvana has been so important. Now, why did I get into this? In 1979, the single which topped the charts worldwide from Australia to Sweden to the United States was this little song, which I will now play to you, assuming that the machine works again. In case you didn't catch the lyrics of that, that was by Pink Floyd from their album The Wall, and the lyrics were, "We don't need no education, we don't need no thought control, no dark sarcasm in the classroom, teachers leave them kids alone." Now in 1979, I happened to be the president of Bucknell University, and it occurred to me that if this was the big hit with my college students, maybe I should pay some attention to it. I mean, if they're singing, "We don't need no education," suppose I were a dentist and people were singing, "We don't need no dentistry," I would be a lot worried about that. So at that point, I started to take a look and see what was going on in pop music. I confess I had not paid much attention to pop music since those days in Chicago when I used to listen to WIND while I was doing my high school algebra work, and I would hear Harbor Lights by Eddie Howard. I was fascinated by the change. Where did this music come from? And what's made it stick around so long? After all, Xavier Cugat gave us the rumba, but it hasn't hung on like rock music. Rock was, it seemed to me, a real revolution in popular music. And since I'm a philosopher by trade, I recall the statement in Plato's Republic that a change in musical style also notes a profound change in general culture. And that was why, for instance, Plato did not want to have the Lydian mode in his ideal state. So is rock music, such as you've heard a little bit of there, is it a culture revolution? Mick Jagger, very famous of the Rolling Stones, states the extreme positions. Quote, "There are two different attitudes, right? One is the English attitude, like when Peter Townshend of the rock group The Who talks about rock and roll like a religion. And then there are others, like me, who think it's a lot of overblown nonsense. And Jagger goes on to quote Johnny Rotten of the Sex Pistols' view that rock is a lot of rubbishy trash. A solemn cultural commentator like Camille Paglia says the rock concert has risen up as a new religion. And Johnny Rotten, who did after all assign rock to rubbishy trash, does seem to confirm Paglia when he said in one of his songs, "I am an antichrist." Maybe the best characterization of rock is that it's rubbishy religion or the religion of rubbish. Either way, it is not lightly to be dismissed. Rock is, in my judgment, a major cultural event. Now, how did we get from Crosby to Cobain? It all starts with Elvis. John Lennon got it right. Quote, "Before Elvis, there was nobody." Elvis showed up at Sun Records in Memphis on July 5th, 1954, a date which should be memorialized along with July 4th. Along with Bill Black and Winfield Scott, he recorded some songs. You could do that for $3.98 for both sides of the record. They started with Harbor Lights, my song from WIND. But during a break, the trio got to playing around. They let loose and ripped through a piece called That's All Right, Mama. Rock was born. The Harbor Lights went out forever in pop music. And I'm sure Mama has never been all right ever since. Now, to appreciate the rock revolution, maybe I should play that piece, in fact, by Elvis, so you could just hear what it sounds like. In case, I mean, this is one of the great moments in American music. This is what changes everything. As I say, how did we get to that music? To appreciate the rock revolution, you have to understand something about the pop music that replaced it, the music that I was listening to back in Chicago in the 40s. That music has been called Tin Pan Alley music after the section on 28th Street in New York between 5th and 6th Avenue where old-time song pluggers used to play the piano to plug sheet music back in the 1890s and beyond. Now, what's important is that it was located in New York City. Up until Elvis, pop music, mainstream music, was New York music. It was produced out of New York, and it had a New York sensibility. It was urban, sophisticated, and dominantly, in fact, the work of Jewish composers. Vernon Duke, Irving Berlin, Richard Rodgers, Vincent Humans, George Gershwin, and Jerome Kern were all Jewish. Some, in fact, had classical backgrounds. As you probably know, Gershwin studied in Paris with Nadia Boulanger, and of course he wrote classical music, and Jerome Kern had studied operetta in Vienna. To take an example of the cultural sophistication of that music, I choose a song which my generation listened to every Tuesday night. If you were in Chicago, it was at 9 o'clock. I suppose here on the East Coast, it was at 10 o'clock, the theme song to Bob Hope's radio show. It was written by Leo Robin and Ralph Ranger. Thanks for the memory of your lips next to mine, castles on the Rhine, the Parthenon, and moonlight on the Hudson River line. Now, the audience for that obviously had some high cultural aspirations, all those memories of castles on the Rhine, the Parthenon, and so on. The music was not only culturally sophisticated, it expressed idealization and deferred gratification. Cole Porter, the ultimate New York composer in many ways, wrote in the 1930s, "You're the tops, you're the Mona Lisa, you're the tops, you're the Tower of Pisa." Well, we're back to high culture again, the Mona Lisa. Now, If you think that your beloved is the Mona Lisa, that idealizes her to a point you may wonder if you ever could possess such a thing as such a person. Who could possess the Mona Lisa? After all, it fit the style of Frank Sinatra's song at that time, "Put Your Dreams Away for Another Day." So here is Frank Sinatra, just to give you a little bit of a rest from the other kind of music. I thought you would, just to remind you what the other music sounded like. Couple. Probably was. The style of Sinatra fit the kind of lyrics that were there, the idea of deferred gratification and a sort of long, smooth line. He was a quintessential Tin Pan Alley singer, and he began his career with Tommy Dorsey and was much influenced by that sentimental gentleman of swing. As one of the things that most interests me is that earlier groups, pop music groups, are all named after sort of people or things. You had the Royal Canadians, you had Friend Waring and his Pennsylvanians, you had that sort of thing. When the new world starts, it turns out this place, people like Monkees and Stones and Beatles and Rocks and things like that. So it's a different thing. But anyhow, Dorsey had the ability to hold a note on his trombone to play without breathing for 16 bars on the trombone. That's quite a feat. And Sinatra trained himself to do exactly the same thing in singing. So you get this long, languid line of Sinatra's song, very different than the kind of situation you get in Elvis Presley. After all, look at the change. What did Cole Porter say? "You're the Tops, you're the Mona Lisa." And Elvis comes to fame singing, "You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog." Now, it's pretty hard to own the Mona Lisa, but a hound dog, yeah, you could certainly have that. The theme, the sensibility of rock music is pretty well summed up in some ways, I think. Not idealization and deferred gratification, it's hound dogs, and nothing's going to be deferred. And I think it's symbolized by two big Rolling Stones albums in the 60s. One's called Satisfaction, and the other one's called Now. The style of the performance, as I say, also fit the rock music. Liza Doolittle in My Fair Lady, who was not herself an urban sophisticated type, says, "Don't talk of love lasting through time. If you're in love, show me." Rock music is not talking about love. It's in the middle of it. Not articulate love ballads, but to quote a description of Elvis's 1955 hit, "Let's Play House," quote, "a wild crash of hiccups, gulps, and baby, baby, babies." Elvis is not talking about playing house. He is playing house. Okay, so that's a quick sketch about the older pop music and the change that's brought about by rock, some of it. Elvis was not, however, a creative genius who invented the rock style. It had deep roots in a musical culture that was not mainstream. Sam Phillips, Elvis's first promoter, the owner of Sun Records in Memphis, said what he'd always wanted was a white man who could sing like a nigger. When Elvis and his pals cut loose with That's All Right, Mama, they were playing a composition by a black songwriter, Arthur Crudup. The roots of rock are in black music and in the black experience. Black music had a vibrant existence far away from New York City. The record companies used to issue records for the black audience. They were called race records by the companies, and they were marketed only to blacks. Elvis knew about that music because he was in Memphis, not because he was in New York. You wouldn't hear that kind of music in New York unless you were in a specialized racial group. But in Memphis, you could hear it almost anywhere. And after all, Memphis is the home of the blues. Now, as the home of the blues. And that's one of the two strands of black music that ends up being transmuted into rock. The blues are songs of loss and heartache. But in the purest black blues, the loss is just not temporary or bad luck. It seems to be fundamental. It expresses in some way the sense of the black population that they are radically excluded from the bright promises of American society. Here are the lyrics for Hellhound on My Tail by Robert Johnson, one of the greatest and most tragic of the blues singers. I gotta keep moving. I gotta keep moving. Blues falling down like hail, blues falling down like hail. And the days keep minding me. There's a hellhound on my tail, a hellhound on my tail. Frank Sinatra could put his dreams away for another day, but surely that day would come. For Robert Johnson, that day would never come. It's a dream forever deferred. The music is not a music of pursuit, as in the love ballads of Tin Pan Alley. It's a music of flight, flight from a hellhound on my tail. The musical style of the blues, Robert Johnson's blues particularly, fits the message. Instead of the grateful, graceful compliments to the beloved, delivered in cultural metaphors, you have a cry of pain over the incessant beat of the guitar, which drives the music forward almost like the hellhound itself. Another strand of black music that goes into rock music and is even more dominant is gospel music. This was something that Elvis knew very well from his experience in Memphis and from the church that he attended. If the blues is a hellish journey, gospel is the realization of salvation in the music itself. Both blues and the gospel music reject any kind of deferral. One is either in the pains of hell, or one has somehow gotten to the very exuberance of salvation through the very music itself. And here is a group called the Bright Clouds singing Jesus Bears. Thank you. sorry to say, that's the last musical excerpt we'll have for the evening. So from now on, it's just me. And you'll be glad if I don't sing. Now, before turning to Nirvana, I said that the black music was underground music. It was. It was not mainstream music. It was underground. It could develop all by itself. I have to go even further underground, unfortunately, to get, it seems to me, around to Nirvana. I have to get an even darker vision or more despairing vision. After all, the black music did have the possibility of some sort of salvation in gospel. So I'm going to take a diversion here to an area that in which many of you may be familiar, and that is I'm going to talk about not music, but I'm going to talk about painting, because it's one of the things I know more about, actually, and know about music. Black music was not mainstream white music, and I think by the time you get to Nirvana, and you get white music. I mean, Elvis was a white musician who could sing like a nigger, but he wasn't a nigger. He wasn't a black. He did not enjoy the kind of cultural sophistication and social cohesion which that black community had. So he's bringing into white music a certain sensibility which is not really backed up by a very deep culture in the way it is in the blacks. And that has its own cost. And that's what I will get around to when I get around to Cobain, who is, of course, another white guy singing a music which has some of the same sensibilities of Robert Johnson. It's a hellhound on my tail. Except for him, as a white guy, he shouldn't have a hellhound on his tail. He should be a hell of a success. Instead of that, he didn't see himself that way. Anyways, I'm going to take a diversion and talk about underground painting, underground art, because it's a way, I think, that is maybe an easier way to understand the sensibility that gets into the kind of music I want to talk about eventually. Now, you may not listen to a lot of this music, but I imagine most of you have been to some modern art gallery. And if you go to a modern art gallery, particularly a very nice modern art gallery, you're probably going to be somewhere between baffled and offended by what you see on display. You're like, you see a Brillo box, a room full of rocks, a repetitive video, an erotic tableau, a portrait of the Madonna decorated with elephant dung. Now, I call your attention to these artifacts because so many of the objects fit the adjective grunge, which has been applied to Nirvana's rock band. Perhaps the paradigm of grunge art is Andre Serrano's Piss Christ, a photo of a crucifix immersed in a bucket of urine. We're a long way from Raphael. Similarly, grunge music does not seem to be in the same musical universe as Mozart. Grunge is often rejected as art. In fact, it seems to be a kind of anti-art. And so it is, the cruder and the messier, the better. Now, how did the plastic arts get so grungy? Well, you can mark the beginning of the radical turn in the plastic arts from the New York Independent Show of 1917. The French artist Marcel Duchamp, who was already famous for his nude descending the stairs, purchased a urinal at a local plumbing shop, signed it, and submitted it to the show under the title Fountain. It was the first of what Duchamp called objets trouvés, found objects. Now, Duchamp did not craft or shape this product. He simply found it and gave it a title. One of the more amusing essays I ever read about Duchamp was some very serious art critic who had gone around and looked at plumbing catalogs from 1917 to discover whether Duchamp had chosen the most elegant and artistic urinal he could possibly find. Now, if you go to the Philadelphia Museum, where all the Duchamp, great Duchamp works are, and you take a look, the urinal will be there, except it's not the same urinal. Duchamp couldn't have cared less. He wanted a urinal, that's what he wanted. He didn't care whether it was artsy or not. Anyhow, this Duchamp did not shape or craft the article, he simply declared it a work of art. It was a piece, in fact, of anti-art. Duchamp's trademark in later years was when he painted a mustache on a lithographic reproduction of the Mona Lisa. So if Cole Porter thought, you're the top, you're the Mona Lisa, Duchamp says, well, let's put a mustache on her and see what she looks like. Anti-art is a put-down, a send-up of the Mona Lisa and of the whole artistic tradition. Now, what's the motive of anti-art? Why would anybody do this sort of thing? A later commentator opines that it is, quote, a drive to wrench art from its normal subject matter and materials so as to bring it closer to, quote, and this is a key word, key phrase, the chaotic vitality of everyday life. Anti-artists are very suspicious of traditional art. It's too shapely, too ordered for life itself. Duchamp used as his pseudonym when he signed things, Rose, c'est la vie. C'est la vie, that's life, c'est la vie, the French. And rose, rose, came from the French arroser, which means to sprinkle. And what you got with Duchamp's art was a sprinkling of life. That's what you could expect. We certainly learn a lot about human life from great artists. But there's a sense in which our life never quite shapes up to an orderly plot. If you decide to live your life as a work of art, you may end up like Emma Bovary, trapped in a romance novel, or Don Quixote, trapped in, driven mad by medieval tales of heroism. You have to be constantly reminded that life goes beyond art, and the motive of anti-art is, how do I capture life itself, not art? How would we characterize life? The chaotic vitality of everyday life, as the critic says. That's the aim of Duchampian art. Life is an exuberance beyond order, or it's a destruction beyond comprehension. Jean Améry, a concentration camp survivor, summed up the failure of art to deal with destruction. Quote, no bridge led from death in Auschwitz to death in Venice. The sensitive and tragic prose of Thomas Mann's novella about death in Venice fails in all ways to reach obscene death as in Auschwitz. When Duchamp takes a urinal and signs his name to it, he translates it from the men's room to the gallery, transubstantiating it from life into art. Duchamp calls attention to the irony of art. Or is it the irony of life by the signature, by the fact that life cannot be signatured? And in case you missed the irony, Duchamp never signed his actual name. He was the supreme ironist of modern art. Life is what you find at hand. Life is the ultimate objet trouvé. That's what you find. It's the ultimate object just there in front of you, not shaped up. To understand rock music, you have to understand the fullness of life, a fullness that goes beyond form and order. It's to life that I want to turn then in discussing Kurt Cobain. Cobain's music was an attempt to encompass life itself as he experienced it, with all of its mess and distress. It was an attempt which eventually destroyed him. Kurt Cobain was born on February the 20th, 1967, to Don and Wendy Cobain in Aberdeen, Washington. Don was 20 and worked as a mechanic at the Chevron station. Wendy was 19, a considerable beauty, who married straight out of high school. Aberdeen was a city in sharp decline. It had 67 taverns in 1967 and was so infamous for the number of whorehouses that Life magazine had called it, quote, one of the hot spots in America's battle against sin. Cobain's parents divorced when he was 8, and a charming, well-adjusted child became a troubled youngster. In his teens, he often had no settled place to stay and claimed later that he slept under the railway bridge in town. In high school, he experimented with drugs, and drug addiction was to shadow his career. At 15, he acquired a guitar. In high school, he met Kurt Novoselic, a fan of punk rock, and eventually they formed a band called Fecal Matter. I told you, the names are not like the Royal Canadians. Eventually, after trying a series of drummers, they enlisted Dave Grohl. Novoselic on bass guitar, Grohl on drums, and Cobain on guitar became Nirvana. After recording locally in Seattle for Sub Pop Records, Nirvana was picked up by a major label, DGC. Nevermind became a worldwide success. Nirvana was the hottest band going in the world. Cobain married a local rocker from Seattle, Courtney Love. They had a child, but were plagued by the child welfare authorities because of the suspicion that drug use imperiled the infant. Nirvana was an underground anti-establishment band, and Cobain could not adjust to being a pop star. He started off recording for something called Sub Pop Records, and when he shifted from Sub Pop Records to Pop Records, that was more than he really wanted or could bear. Fame, plus drugs, plus persistent ill health were piled onto the scars and depressions from his childhood. On April the 5th, 1994, just 3 years after Nirvana became a public sensation, Cobain committed suicide in his home in Seattle. Now, Nirvana is not every rock band that ever was or will be, but Smells Like Teen Spirit was recently voted the top single of the past 25 years. I noticed, for instance, there was an article in the New York Times, a review of a book on the death of rock. It was a fiction story about somebody talking about how the rock is now gone, and the reviewer said, yeah, that's all very well and good, but the guy never mentions Kurt Cobain. So Cobain is still around as a figure. I've chosen it for two reasons. Why did I pick it? I've chosen it for two reasons. First, it is one of those apocalyptic bands that emphasize the idea of the rock revolution. It is a fundamental spiritual movement for its followers. A Generation X fan from Pennsylvania writes, Nirvana was the band that changed the world. And not only the music world, but the world in general. In keeping with the apocalyptic importance of the band, the major biography of Kurt Cobain is called Heavier Than Heaven, the slogan of the band's first European rock tour. The second reason is that Cobain represents the revolutionary aspirations and the risks of rock. I want to suggest that Nirvana's grunge rock and the life and death of Kurt Cobain contain deep spiritual currents which I think continue in youth culture. I think Peter Townshend and Camille Paglia are right. It is worth thinking about rock as a kind of religion. Heavier Than Heaven does label the spiritual quest of the band. I started by saying that there was no connection between the band and Buddhism, but maybe Nirvana is, in a very strange way, their common quest. Nirvana and grunge rock is best understood as anti-art, anti-music, reaching beyond form toward life in its full density. One key to how rock moves beyond art is how it deals with words. What happens to the words in rock music? What happens? You can't understand them. That is the standard complaint of old fogies like myself. Now, that's more than an idiosyncrasy of us old folks who could follow Frank Sinatra. It's deliberate on the part of the rock musician. For many years, performers resisted printing lyrics on the dust jackets or the CD packets. Fans would spend hours trying to decipher the various shouts and screams of the stars. One commentator frankly admits that the words of Smells Like Teen Spirit are incomprehensible. Quote, a typically murky Cobain exploration of meaning and meaninglessness. The phrase, teen spirit, where did that come from? It's the name of a teenage deodorant. There are occasional words which filter up, like albino, mosquito, and libido, but you don't have to worry about whether they add up to anything. The critic just quoted continues, while the songs on Nevermind wouldn't offer much explicit, easily grasped meaning, the lyrics were uttered with one voice of wrath, rage, disgust, and humor that came through perfectly clearly, no matter how inscrutable the words were. In rock, the word suffers collapse. It's submerged in an ocean of sound and beat. The words are a mystery because life escapes being described in articulate form. The failure of the articulate word was central to Kurt Cobain's life and world. If anti-art hopes to encompass the chaos, Cobain was obsessed with chaos. Here's an excerpt from one of his less offensive efforts. An inscription he wrote on the wall of his bedroom. Loser, wino, alcoholic, scum, trash, head lice, scabs, infection, diarrhea, vomits blood, urine, malfunctioning bowel. Anti-art, as I said, goes beyond art. Art attempts to impale life itself in its chaos as a waste beyond form. Waste? After all, Duchamp did start it all off with the urinal. And look at the waste in Cobain's litany. Scum, trash, head lice, diarrhea, vomits, urine, functioning bowel. All that is certainly part of life, but not the sort of thing we normally talk about in polite company or in humanities lectures at the Ilsley Library, as a matter of fact. It's no accident that Cobain called his first band Fecal Matter. Cobain and Nirvana wanted a music that signified life as waste and chaos. Sometimes life for Cobain was a vital chaos, but it often seemed to him just a nauseous mess. He suffered from continual stomach pain. His life presented three escapes from the pain of chaos: rock music, heroin, and death. At the end of the chaotic litany of mess, which I just quoted, he wrote, quote, unable to form a sentence. We're back again with the failure of words. In rock music, the word collapses. By shouting out the pain in half-heard words and enveloping into the music, the uncontrollable is expressed, put out there in the public. And in that sense, it can be somewhat captured and encompassed. Cobain immerses himself fully into a chaos of sound. He shouts out the phrases from the obscenities of life and then drowns them or baptizes them in this ocean of sound. For the moment, he gains some control. For the moment, the audience is caught up in a range of controlled chaos. Unhappily for Cobain, when the music stopped, what remained was only silence and unutterable chaos, scum, trash, diarrhea, unable to utter a sentence. The final failure of the music to contain chaos could be symbolized by the fact that one of the trademarks of Nirvana was that they destroyed their instruments at the end of the gig. For Cobain, since the music could not really encompass chaos, he turned to drugs and finally to suicide. Toward the end, where Nirvana was at the peak of its popularity, Kurt became less and less capable of performing in public. In his suicide note, his anguish as a public persona became central. On our last three tours, I've had a much better appreciation for all the people I've known personally and as fans of our music. But I still can't get over the frustration, the guilt and empathy I have for everyone. There's good in all of us. And I think I simply love people too much. So much that it makes me feel too fucking sad. The sad, little, sensitive, unappreciative Pisces Jesus man. I can't get over the frustration, the guilt, the empathy that I have for everyone. Empathy I have for everyone. My old friend and Orthodox priest, John Garvey, once imagined a science fiction character he called an empath. If you could be that science fiction creature, the empath, someone who could walk down the street and absorb the suffering of the people you passed, you would probably be destroyed within a few blocks if you could get that far. I think of pastors, nurses, doctors, and other people whose work makes them take in great drafts of sorrow. There's a glut of suffering at every level: depression, physical illness, mental illness, resentment, the hard-heartedness and self-righteousness of people who refuse to be reconciled, poverty, war, torture inflicted by states, torment inflicted by families, and bereavement. When you understand that suffering and sorrow are essential to what it means to be human, you begin to see something that Christianity has appreciated. In his suicide note, Cobain got it right. He called himself Jesus Man. Garvey reflects the claim of Christianity that Jesus, in some sense, was supposed to exemplify the empath, one who could take on the suffering of the world. Cobain wanted to take on the suffering of all his fans, and it destroyed him. One of the lines in Teen Spirit that's relatively clear, and everybody got, was, "Here we are now, entertain us." It was a line that Cobain liked to use when he walked into a party. Let me play with that line as a way of interpreting the way in which rock music inhabits spiritual space. I think that the basic message of rock is, here we are now, in the opening moments of Teen Spirit, Cobain is screaming, hello, 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 hello. Yelling hello is a cry for recognition. Here we are now, entertain us. Hello, hello, hello. The deepest spiritual question is, does anyone say hello back? Who acknowledges, here we are now? There are two levels to the word entertain. Here we are now, entertain us. On the one hand, it may mean amuse us. But it may be a deeper message. Recognize us. When the ambassador says to the potentate, will you entertain my request? He's not asking for amusement. He's asking that his request be taken seriously. One could say that humanity's deepest cry is, here we are now, with the plea that there would be someone who will entertain that we exist. Entertaining our existence is recognizing us in the very fullness of our life, in the chaos of pain and joy, which we cannot finally encompass in words, in the loneliness of the inexpressible. If there is no one who entertains us, then life can seem merely waste, chaos, and destruction. Cobain hated performing before large crowds, both at the first and at the last. His earlier dislike was because he thought that the audience did not understand the passionate moral convictions expressed in his music. He was a crusader for gay rights and for women. In the two meanings of entertain, he thought that his audiences wanted mere entertainment, to be amused, and they missed the message. Later, in his suicide note, he suggests his problem with the audience was radically different. It wasn't that they missed the moral message of the earlier period, it was they were expressing the same need as the performer. Cobain, in his loneliness, wanted to be recognized. Here we are now, entertain us. And the audience, in its loneliness, wanted the same recognition. Here we are now, entertain us. And if you see a video, for instance, of the rock concerts, the audience actually came up on the stage. They were forever leaping up on the stage, and then, in a kind of great gesture, sort of like one of Kierkegaard's leaps of faith, they would leap back into the audience, and hoping that somebody would catch them when they went off the platform. Cobain named the band Nirvana because he thought it meant perfection. Perfection in music was intended to encompass suffering, but at the end he realizes the failure of art, and so he falls into the chaos that he could no longer sustain. You can't be Jesus man and take on the suffering of the world. You'd have to be Jesus God. John Lennon said that the Beatles were bigger than Jesus Christ. Johnny Rotten said he was Antichrist. Cobain came to see himself as Jesus man. Whether rock is a religion or rubbish, it seems to be playing in the religion ballpark. I would be inclined to say that what Cobain was trying to accomplish was a kind of religion or a spiritual high. Or if religion sounds too presumptuous. It was a spiritual musical vision which could transubstantiate the waste of life that he wrote about on his bedroom wall and make it into an affirmation. I spend all this time on Nirvana because it continues as a strand of youth culture. And rock music, it seems to me, does exist in a kind of spiritual space. I started off by talking about the fact that I got interested in this because Pink Floyd was singing, "We Don't Need No Education." And I think for educators, like myself and so many in this room, this is a real problem. Rock poses a challenge to the very careful, diffident discourse of academic life. But then so does life itself. So if we say to our kiddos every day in class, you got to talk in this way, you got to be very careful, you got to have everything ordered, you got to have set, but my life isn't that ordered. And if you're a teenager, it's particularly not terribly well ordered. So you may say, I want to go someplace where the me is actually affirmed, where the very sense of disorder and chaos and the feelings which I can't contain are really expressed. And rock music says, yeah, that's where I am. I entertain you. I entertain you. I understand where you're at. The Catholic spiritual writer Rosemary Houghton expressed the diffidence of academic discourse in a critique of neo-Thomist philosophy. The curious Puritan fastidiousness of neo-Thomism neatly crossing the river by stepping on well-balanced stones without noticing the water. I think rock notices the water and demonstrates that if you're not careful, you can drown. And the real problem is, how do you swim in the water of life and not drown? That, it seems to me, is the challenge of rock. So that's the end of the talk. And I could entertain a question as I tried to entertain you. And if you want to read some more about this, I checked out, you can get these books at the Ilsley Library. The two that I would recommend, if you want to know all about Kurt Cobain, there it is. This is Heavier Than Heaven. And this is by far, I think, one of the great books ever written about pop music, about rock music, about Elvis Presley. The end of the book, by, it's by Greil Marcus, and it's in the library upstairs. And it ends with a long, long essay called Presleyad, after Iliad. And the argument is Elvis Presley is the greatest figure in American history. And when you get done reading that essay, you may actually believe that. The other two books that I brought along were more for continuous entertainment. This is just another one of these sort of books that, it seems to me, points out to the sort of religious quality of this. This is a book on the Beatles called The Music of the Beatles, subtitled The Twilight of the Gods. But these are two of my favorite books. This is for those of you who don't know much about Elvis. This is Elvis in comic book style. So this is called Elvis for Beginners. Or my absolutely favorite book on Elvis is this one, All Shook Up, Elvis Day by Day, 1954 to 1977. So since this is March 3rd, I looked up what March 3rd 50 years ago was as far as Elvis was concerned. Elvis's military transport arrived at McGuire Air Force Base, New Jersey at 7:42 in a driving snowstorm, et cetera, et cetera. Among the people in attendance at the press conference was Colonel Parker. That was Elvis's promoter, a real scallywag. When asked how much Elvis's army salary was, he replied, "I don't know. I don't get a commission on that." However, he did add that he wanted the press to, quote, "please state that the government gets 91% of Elvis's tax earnings." Elvis is not a millionaire. He added that Elvis's gross earnings in 1959 were $1.9 million. So, as I say, if you want to know what Elvis was doing in any day, look up your birthday and so forth. There it is, all there. So, anyhow, that will give you some idea of things you want to continue to read. Anyhow, I'll try to answer questions, though, as I say, I'm not an expert on rock music at all, but or any other topic you'd like to talk about, I'd be glad to take a whack at it. One of the virtues of being a university president, I found, was you can talk about anything at length, usually about 40 minutes. Yes, Gary.